And now we come to the most alarming delusion of all. Imagine a cave where those inside never see the outside world. Instead, they see shadows of that world projected on the cave wall. The world they see in the shadows is not the real world. But it's real to them. If you were to show them the world as it actually is, they would reject it as incomprehensible. Now what if, instead of being in a cave, you were out in the world, except you couldn't see it? Because you weren't looking. Because you trusted that the world you saw through the prism was the real world. But there's a difference. You see, unlike the allegory of the cave, where the people are real and the shadows are false, here, other people are the shadows, their faces, their lives. This is the delusion of the narcissist, who believes that they alone are real. Because other people are just shadows, and shadows don't feel. Because they're not real. But what if everyone lived in caves? Then no one would be real. Not even you. Unless one day you woke up and left the cave. How strange the world would look after a lifetime of staring at shadows.
Unless you're ironically embedded in your mobile device or PC, I'm sure you're getting this allegory on history's most famous allegory and history's primordial Gnostic warning. Plato's cave is not only true, but it's been further weaponized in our digital age. We're trapped in that witching screen, unable to face our shadow and treating others like shadows. Collectively atomizing human empathy and human understanding and human imagination. It's worse than ever. The Archons got us cucked and cornered, my beloved True Seekers.
Our impulses are being redirected. We are living in an artificially induced state of consciousness that resembles sleep.
And that clip is from the series Legion, which I still haven't fully seen, but I am trying to get out of my own witching screen. As Tom Waits once said, we are buried under the weight of information, which is being confused with knowledge. Quantity is being confused with abundance, and wealth with happiness. We are monkeys with guns and money. Yes, I would add we are monkeys with small, personal obelisks from 2001 A Space Odyssey, custom made by our stellar overlords.
Like a monkey ready to be shot into space. Space monkey, ready to sacrifice himself for the greater good.
Like me, you have materialized here at the virtual Alexandria because you want to get out of your own micro-Plato's cave and abort this Armageddon of all that is sane. It's no accident Simon and Helen sent you here. And on this episode, a fabulous astral guest will argue that it began with Plato and his allegory. Perhaps sooner with the cult of Orpheus, and that quest to find that holy sunlight of enlightenment has never stopped. from the Greek philosophers to the Christian Gnostics to the Hermetics to the Neoplatonists to the mystic Greek Orthodox to the Kabbalists to the Sufis to the secret societies to today. Today for us to embrace and use to break out of our micro-Plato's cave. We allogenes, or those strangers in the Gnostic Gospels.
My father says that almost the whole world is asleep. Everybody you know, everybody you see, everybody you talk to. He says that only a few people are awake, and they live in a state of constant, total amazement.
This is Aeon by Gnostic Radio, an initiation by conversation into the dark corners of myth, magic, and meaning. A crash course in cult culture and conspiracy. A virtuous virus invoking and informing history, holiness, and heresy. Each week I, your host Miguel Connor, commandeers your connection to bring the most accepted and rejected scholars and provocateurs to your attention. Fun, compelling, and deeply weird, this is the blow-your-mind cocktail party conversation you always wanted to listen in on.
Are you not entertained? Are you not entertained? Is this not why you are here?
Welcome so much to that dream of you, that distant ship smoke on the horizon. Are you ready for the greatest odyssey in your many existences? Are you ready to continue running with those searching for the truth and avoiding those who have found it? Are you ready for a near-life experience and getting out to feel that holy sunlight of enlightenment on your brow after so many incarnations as a slave to Jehovah and his angelic mafia?
Smite me, almighty smiter!
Puny god.
As mentioned, we are joined by a fabulous astral guest. That is Nicolas Laos, whose esoteric and scholarly resume is as long as Jormungand or a McCain funeral. What an honor and what a kind soul. Nicolas materializes at the virtual Alexandria to discuss his latest book, The Meaning of Being Illuminati. I love reading the spanning work that was a manual for personal freedom, as it was a keen history of esotericism in the vein of Gary Lachman or Tobias Churton. As it was a tome of socioeconomic truths and philosophical insights for future possibilities. Don't expect any conspiracies on the Illuminati here, although Nicolas does go deep about the Bavarian Brotherhood in his book.
Was he working for someone?
Yes, working for God.
So God ordered a hit on an investment bank.
There's an awful lot that you don't know.
No, expect the eternal quest for inner illumination, more needed than ever. For more information on Nicolas and his Ur Illuminati movement, please go to, you got it, nicolaslaos.com. Or check out our show notes.
In other words, we're talking about an underground, which did exist in a different way during the Dark Ages among the mystical orders of the Church. And the purpose of this underground is to find out how to preserve the light, life, the culture, how to keep things living.
Yes, we're trapped in micro-Plato caves. The Archons got us cucked and cornered. And I agree with Nicolas, Jay Dyer, and others. The only thing that will save us is a spiritual solution. I agree too with the brilliant Jungian analyst, Laura London, who says that until we, as a people, confront our collective shadow, the meanness and violence and rank collective narcissism isn't going to end. addiction, suicide, crime, and existential despair will continue to rise. And relationships and communities will continue to crumble.
What happened to the American dream?
It came true! You're looking at it.
There is no other way, don't you see? Getting rid of Trump, or banning guns, or stopping brown immigrants, or arresting Hillary, or one-party rule, or doxing, or socialism, or capitalism, or all of that is not going to make a difference.
I want peace on earth and goodwill toward men.
We are the United States government. We don't do that sort of thing.
Beyond facing our collective shadow, each one of us must take an inner journey. That personal, artful monomyth. To face those dark psychic forces Marianne spoke about. As Peter Gabriel sang in The Carpet Crawlers, you gotta get in to get out. And as the Nag Hammadi Library's Three Steles of Seth says, the way of ascent is the way of descent. And we must teach ourselves those infinite things. There are no saviors out there, you see. In fact, you can't save yourself, but your inner journey will. As the logos and wisdom will manifest each step you take to find your soul and daemon. And you'll feel the holy sunlight of enlightenment and that starry sky of liberating symbols, allegory, and archetypes.
You want to understand the universe, embrace the universe. The door to the universe is you.
You are the final authority, have always been. Or more like your higher self. The part of you they suppress as they dropped you into a meat sack. There is no other way. It must be a spiritual solution that starts from within. Going into those caverns to face those dragons of your egoic desires and the nagas of your deepest fears. There is no other way.
Psychologically, the dragon is one's own binding of oneself to one's ego.
We are divine, indeed, but we should not desire to be like the creator gods, which is something the Gnostics get accused of. Sure, weaponized Gnosticism is an effective tool of the rulers of this age. It's easy. Tell someone they're a god, promise them a pleroma on earth, and then let them loose on archons that are actually their own projected insecurities. Happens all the time.
Monsieur! Has it worked?
You will be a weapon. You will be a minister of death, praying for war.
But as Nicolas mentions in the interview, we are meant to be a god without losing our humanity. The ancient Gnostics explain that Gnosis was intended to make us liberated from the wheel of karma, healers of the sick, and heroic in heart. Like April DeConnick wrote in The Gnostic New Age, the ultimate concern of the Gnostic is to awaken the divine potential in each of us, to bring our permanent, deep self to consciousness. We are where the rising ape meets the fallen angel. We are where imagination and potential is self-actualized. We are divine and human, not shadows. Not bespoke Yaldibaldis ruling our digital fiefdoms.
Mankind is poised midway between the gods and the beasts.
Don't know what else I can say, so let us end with the words of Philip K. Dick. Gnosticism is virtually a sign value reversal religion. That is, it assumes the ostensible reality to be a fraud, concealing the true story, which is 180 degrees opposite. hence the need for the revelation of the Gnosis. Everything must be read backward. We are secretly in a giant prison, secretly in thrall. There is a deliberated occlusion practiced on us by hostile warders. The truth is not just hidden, it is deliberately hidden to keep us in ignorance. Were we to know the truth, all would be turned around, all that we see. There is, then, in Gnosticism, a built-in revolutionary, subversive basis fighting the ruling powers of this world. This is the AM Byte interview. And with us, we definitely have the pleasure of being joined by Nicolas Laos to discuss his book, The Meaning of Being Illuminati. How are you, Nicolas? And welcome to the show. Glad to have you on.
I'm very well, partaking of your triptych, coffee, cigars, and Gnosis, of course.
You remember. Love it.
Of course. And thank you very much, Miguel, for inviting me to participate in your enlightening and influential radio program.
Oh, well, I truly appreciate it. And the show is as good as the guests, and we have great guests and who put out some very exciting and important work to help us out in these very strange days. And you are certainly one of them. I really enjoyed your book. But before we get into that, of course, I'd like to always welcome the Moondog Vance. How are you doing, Vance?
I'm fine. I'm anxious to be illuminated about the Illuminati.
You will be, because this is a really good book. And Nicolas, again, I really enjoyed it. It was, to me, it was a journey through time, but not, it was scholarly. It was insightful. You put a lot of great gems in there about how to see the world. But it is a book that can really help an individual, a society, and a culture, which we need more than ever in these very odd changing times. So I really appreciate you writing this book. I really enjoyed it.
Thank you very much indeed for your encouragement, attention, and allow me to say contribution as well, in the sense that you have been a source of inspiration.
No, well, thank you again. I really appreciate it. Again, I think all of us here in the esoteric heretical circles inspire each other. We need each other. We are in the niches, in the bardos of the world, but I think we can make the difference, and we are making a difference. And of course, your book is, again, it's spanning, it's historical, it's inspirational. It offers insights on so many things. So it's hard to, I don't even know what would be the entry point. I mean, we could easily spend a show on each chapter because, again, there's so much, you cover so much ground in just a few pages with each chapter and so forth. So why don't we start with you? Tell us a little bit about yourself. I mean, you have been in many quote-unquote secret societies, although you're very transparent at the beginning of the book of who you are, what you're doing, what you're attempting to do, the struggles you've had in different organizations. So maybe tell the audience about that and who were your influences.
Oh, thank you. As I explain in the introduction to the book, I have, of course, deep, I could say, experience in Freemasonry. I'm still active in several orders there. And of course, I try always to approach Freemasonry from a philosophical perspective, which I try to elucidate in this book, combining my academic life with my Masonic and esoteric life. And the combination between the two has led me to a peculiar perception of Illuminism, which I try to delineate in this book. So if I could describe it in very few words, this book is primarily a study of light. So in this book, I study all different kinds of light, including the physical light, namely the light of the physical universe, and the technological and hence artificial light, which is a scientific achievement of the human being. But the kinds of light with which my book is primarily concerned are what we symbolically call the light of consciousness, and above all, the mysterious and uncreated light of the deity, which not only holds the cosmos together as I see it, but also deifies those human beings who partake of it. Here I have to acknowledge my colleagues in the fields of philosophy and philosophical theology around the world, with whom I discuss these issues systematically. So the study of the light of consciousness is mainly equivalent to the study of history of art, history of philosophy, mythology, and history of science, of course, while the study of God's uncreated light is equivalent to the study of the borderline issues of ontology and human existence, including the potential of the human being to participate in God's uncreated energies and thus to exist according to the divine mode of being. So I have coined the term Ur-Illuminism in order to refer to a new research program whose purpose is to articulate a general theory of illumination covering all the aforementioned kinds of light. And in fact, this is the central objective of the scholarly and political order of the Ur-Illuminati, which together with the few other scholarly oriented Freemasons around the world I have founded and whose ethos I structure and delineate in my book. Thus, in order to distinguish my conception of illumination and illuminism from other conceptions of illumination or illuminism, I have used the German term Ur, which denotes that something or someone embodies the basic or essentially deepest qualities of a particular class or type. And especially regarding my book, I would like to acknowledge the prominent Italian Freemason and scholar, Professor Giuliano Di Bernardo, for contributing a long and highly informative prefatory note, as well as my editor at Cambridge Scholars Publishing for our very efficient cooperation. And something related to the spirit of Aeon Bike Radio. In my book, I contemplate the good in itself, the real good, as an asymmetric threat against evil. And I contemplate spirituality as a particular kind of asymmetric warfare against principalities and powers of this world. In fact, I should clarify that instead of assuming that evil is an autonomous substance or one of God's own reason principles or logi, I maintain that the source of evil is humanity's own will, and that evil consists in the intentional negation of the sociality of the human soul, that is the intentional negation of the receptiveness of the human soul. So, as we read in the Gospel of Mark, evil comes from within, out of a person's heart, and it is represented by and manifested as a closed, deterministically organized and selfish show. So I dare to say that the way in which I interpret Orthodox Christian mysticism, specifically Hesychasm, satisfies and indeed goes beyond the most radical forms of Luciferian and Gnostic humanism in the following sense. The human being should not merely be as God, as Luciferian radicalism proclaims, but the human being should be God. You should not merely be as gods, not as God, but you should be God, according to the Gospel of John, where Jesus Christ says, you are gods. The aforementioned ontological statement is the quintessence of medieval hesychasm as elucidated in my book. And after all, in the original text of the second epistle of Peter, Christ is referred to as the morning star, the light bearer, phosphorus, which is the Greek word for the Latin term Lucifer. In addition, I try to show that beyond the various differences between particular Gnostic schools, the core of Gnosticism is the wish and the attempt to spiritualize the world. And this goal is part of medieval hesychasm as elucidated in my book. So this is how I would very briefly describe my attempt to address the issue of illumination in my work.
Very well said, Nicolas. And yes, I would certainly agree with you. It seems your book is about, again, the illumination of the individual. You just describe it very well. Let's first get into some terms, and then we can go down the historical path, because your book does a great job of pulling the thread. And for the audience, like Nicolas said, he does a lot of science, a lot of philosophy. It's the complete heretical enchilada, as I like to say. But what would you say is, for example, the difference between illuminism and, let's say, esoteric or occult?
Indeed, this is a very important question, because I would say that from a certain viewpoint, illuminism can be considered as the purpose of esotericism. In this sense, I try to address in my book the term esotericism, first of all, in an etymological sense. So even though the term esotericism is controversial, I try to approach it in very basic terms. So the term esotericism derives from the Greek root eso, which means inner. And specifically, Plato, in his dialogue Alcibiades, uses the expression ta eso, meaning the inner things. And in his dialogue Theaetetus, he uses the expression ta exo, meaning the outside things. We have the adjective esoteric, which means the inner reality, the inner life, what transcends the level of pure biology or physicality, and is concerned and refers to the freedom of spirit. And starting from this perspective, I try to combine this approach to esotericism, this basic definition of esotericism, with Plato's myth of the cave, which is a very well-known parable presented by Plato in his book, The Republic, in order to illustrate our nature in its education and want of education. So imagine, says Plato, a cave in which prisoners are chained since their birth in such a way that they can see only shadows thrown on a wall in front of them. They would have the illusion that these shadows were reality. If, however, one of them were freed and he managed to emerge into the sunlight, he would acquire a new kind of knowledge, and he would realize how limited his vision was in the cave. And if you allow me, I would like at this point to very shortly present what Plato identifies as the four levels of knowledge and mental development.
Yes, please do, Nicolas.
Thanks. So the first and most elementary level of knowledge and mental development is illusion or conjecture. In Greek, ikasia. This provides only the most primitive and unreliable opinions. Illusion is the level of knowledge at which one establishes arbitrary correspondences between reality and the things that are present in one's consciousness. So at this level of cognitive development, a person cannot discriminate between reality and that which one would wish to be real. In other words, such a person cannot accurately discriminate between things and their images. The second level of knowledge and mental development above that of illusion is belief, in Greek pistis. Belief is an experiential form of knowledge that allows one to discriminate between objects and their images, shadows, but it lacks epistemological and methodological rigor. Therefore, in his Republic, Plato argues that at the level of belief, one can indeed discriminate between the images of the things and the prototypes, but at this cognitive level, one has not developed scientific consciousness yet. So now we proceed to the third level of knowledge and mental development, which is rule-based reasoning or logic, in Greek, dianoia. This leads to what we could call systematic knowledge of the objects of consciousness through a disciplined application of understanding. As a matter of fact, by the term science, I mean an intentional and methodical endeavor whose purpose is to identify the reason of beings and things. And by the term logic, I refer to the expression of one's need to explain the itinerary of the previous endeavor, namely science, to others by using formal language. However, Plato maintains logic is not a cognitively self-sufficient structure, and therefore it is not the ne plus ultra degree of mental development. Plato's argument about logic was, as a matter of fact, mathematically confirmed in 1931 by the Austrian mathematician and logician Kurt Gödel, who published his seminal article on formally undecidable propositions of Principia Mathematica and related systems. And in that article, Gödel proved that for any computable axiomatic system that contains the finitary arithmetic, namely basic arithmetic, the following theorems hold. Firstly, if the system is consistent, it cannot be complete. And secondly, the consistency of the axioms cannot be proven within the system. And I'm saying this as a mathematician, as a matter of fact. The Italian mathematician and logician, Pier Giorgio Odifredi, commenting upon Gödel's theorems, has pointed out that the axioms of proof cannot be demonstrated by appealing to themselves. So in general, Gödel's groundbreaking theorems imply that truth transcends any formal model of reality. And now we are ready to ascend to the fourth level of knowledge and mental development, which according to Plato is intelligence, in Greek, noesis. According to Plato, intelligence is the supreme level of knowledge, and it corresponds to the knowledge of the good in itself, the absolute. Plato calls the method that leads to the knowledge of the good in itself, or the real, good, dialectic. And we should not confuse the Platonic perception and definition of dialectic with the modern Hegelian perception of dialectic reasoning. According to Plato, dialectic is simultaneously a logical and supralogical method of knowledge. It is logical in the sense that the knowledge of the real good presupposes that one's consciousness has progressed from the first level of knowledge, ikasia, or illusion, to the third level of knowledge, dianoia, or rule-based reasoning. And it is supralogical in the sense that a conscious being that has assimilated logic is aware of the limits of logic and has acquired a supralogical, intuitive kind of knowledge. Hence, as we read in Plato's Republic, as well as in the entire Platonic dialogue Phaedro, the relationship between the philosopher and the good in itself is not only a cognitive one, but also an erotic one. And Plato's notion of intelligence is a kind of spiritual intuition about which we read in the Bible too. This kind of spiritual intuition is the core of medieval mysticism and of hesychasm, which is the quintessence of somehow Eastern Roman mysticism, and I studied systematically in my book.
Well said, Nicolas, and yes, I agree. I would tell the audience your section on Greek Orthodox is wonderful. In fact, you quote Maximus the Confessor, who says, "We can become divine without losing our humanity." And I think that's very important, because a lot of these esoteric groups are accused of being, we want to be a god, but we end up being the creator distant deist gods, and that creates a lot of issues down on earth. Saying we can become divine without losing our humanity certainly hearkens to the ancient Gnostics, and there's a thread from the Christian Gnostics and the Hermetics to Greek Orthodox mysticism. I've studied this. You do a great job of showing this thread, this evolution, and it really comes down, as you write, that how you emphasize that Christ is the archetypal man. He is the archetype of the free person, the illuminated person.
Oh, indeed, yes. This is a very important issue where I think we can find a very useful and intellectually fruitful convergence between what we call esoteric Christianity in general, Orthodox Christian mysticism, and the core of the Gnostic quest. Because it is very important, for instance, to bear in mind that speaking of Christ as the archetype of the perfected humanity, Gregory the Theologian, also known as Gregory of Nazianzus, who was a 4th century AD Greek Archbishop of Constantinople and philosopher, has written in his oration on Easter that he honors, he writes this literally, and quote-unquote, honors Christ as our archetype. And he uses this word exactly. And moreover, in his homily in Transfigurationem Domini, John of Damascus, an 8th century Syrian monk, theologian and philosopher and priest, speaking of the deification of humanity, refers to the divine image in humanity as it is mingled with Christ the archetype. And the term archetype is used by him. Since you mentioned also Maximus the Confessor, it is very important to remind our audience that from his perspective, the God and humanity are each other's image, which is a very bold statement. But of course, this is delineated in a very systematic way. And I think that this leads also to the to a systematic unification between philosophy and theology.
Indeed, it does. I think I love again how you're writing about the Greek Orthodox Church, how it talks about there's the essence of God, the uncreated essence, and then there's the energies of God that we can participate. Those are created. Of course, it reminds me the Pleroma becoming conscious and all that. So this is one way we humans can, again, become divine is by participating in these energies, which goes back to the your all idea of the light, of the Ur. I'm thinking of the Ein Sof Ur also.
Absolutely, indeed, yes. And I think that this is the defining characteristic and the most important element of the path that during the Middle Ages, because the modern era is another story, that during the Middle Ages, Eastern Roman Christian mysticism followed. I think that, as I said before, the theology of the Greek Church Fathers, specifically the way that Greek Christians interpreted Christ's work, was underpinned by classical Greek philosophy. And here, if I may, I should rather refer to Plato and Aristotle, who used the term theoria, which is a Greek term that literally means gaze. And according to Plato and Aristotle, theoria brings the philosopher's life to completion and conclusion. And according to the Greek philosophical conception of theoria, theoria should not be identified with scientific theorizing. From the perspective of the classical Greek philosophers, theoria means direct knowledge of the eternal being and identification with it. For this reason, the life of theoria is the philosopher's way of life. So we have philosophy as a way of life, and it consists in the love of wisdom. And wisdom is, in fact, is the beginning and the result of philosophy, which gazes at and accesses the totality of the being of the cosmos. And together with the deity, it enjoys the pleasures of the mind. According to Plato, humanity's access to the deity is a transcendent experience, and apart from the development of human reason, it necessarily presupposes a kind of psychic cleansing or cure. Similarly, according to Aristotle's philosophy, humanity's access to the deity presupposes the perfection of the human mind. And based on these classical Greek philosophical arguments, which, as a matter of fact, disclosed and elucidated the life of the spirit, what Greek church fathers did was to maintain that the achievement of theoria within this world and within this psychosomatic nexus can be achieved by contemplating on a logos who is spiritual, namely totally free from the logic of the material world, and simultaneously this logos can unite the material world with himself. Thus, classical Greek thought found the solution that it had been looking for in the mystical interpretation of Christianity and of the doctrine of the incarnation of the Logos Because as we read in Nicomachean Ethics, Aristotle argues more or less as follows. On the one hand, happiness is coextensive in its range with contemplation and inner life, but at the same time, we are material and historical beings. And the philosopher, being a man, will also need external well-being, since man's nature is not self-sufficient for the activity of contemplation. And therefore, we have to find a logos which is free from the logic of material and historical necessities, but at the same time can deify us while we are material and historical beings. And I would like to mention that one of the early Greek apologists and martyrs, as a matter of fact, Justin, philosopher and martyr. Justin, philosopher and martyr, was a second century AD theologian, philosopher, and martyr, of course. And in his dialogue with Trifo, he argues that philosophy is a great possession and most honorable before God, and he maintains that those who have bestowed attention on philosophy are truly holy men, thus endorsing a deeply philosophical attitude towards religion, and in fact indirectly proposing the transition from basic religion to spirituality, which is a more elevated way of approach and religion.
Indeed, I think the warning has been there from Socrates to Jung. We must live that inner life, take that inner journey to find that light. And of course, it should be mentioned that the Hermetic principles greatly influenced the Byzantine Empire. Well, they called themselves Rome, Eismenos Rome. And Hermes Trismegistos was as influential as Plato and Socrates and all those guys, and perhaps we can talk a little bit about that when you want, Nicolas. But I wanted to ask you before we go forward, something that your book talks about a lot. This is important because we can do all these exercises and so forth, and sometimes we throw a lot of words, and but what exactly does the term meaning mean? What is telos?
This is a very, very interesting question. if I can say it very briefly, as I understand it, and I try to explain it more deeply in my book, by the term meaning, I mean that something refers to something else that transcends it, in order to avoid a vicious or a virtuous cycle, and to pursue spiritual freedom and completion. So something is meaningful if it refers to something else that transcends it, instead of me, instead of merely being a means towards another goal. And therefore, telos is inextricably linked to the notion of salvation, but in a very esoteric way of understanding it. The word salvation, which as I said, is inextricably linked to the notion of telos. The word salvation as telos is derived from the late Latin word salvationem, which comes from the Latin verb salvare, which itself is derived from the Latin salvus, meaning healthy or safe. However, there's a deeper etymology and interpretation. The Proto-Indo-European root of salvus is solvos, the base of which is sol, meaning whole, complete. Therefore, at the deepest level of etymological analysis, salvation means existential wholeness. And this is the ultimate meaning of existence from the perspective of the esoteric approach that I follow in my work.
No, that makes perfect sense. And of course, we should talk about the logos. How would you define the logos, or how has the logos evolved in different systems?
Indeed, this is another key issue.
Yes, we have to know these things.
Logos is, again, another controversial term, and there are different ways of approaching it. The term is initially related to another Greek term, which is aletheia, or truth. So if we study the genealogy of the term logos, we have to go back to the term, to the interplay between the terms logos and aletheia, or truth, as Heidegger, for instance, has attempted to clarify these terms. So the Greek word aletheia, meaning truth, is a combination of the prefix a, signifying lack, and the Greek word lethe, meaning forgetfulness. Therefore, for the ancient Greeks, truth means unforgetfulness or unconcealment and disclosure. And according to the German philosopher Martin Heidegger, aletheia, or truth, should be related to the notion of disclosure, or the way in which things appear as entities in the world. The term that the ancient Greeks used in order to refer to the event of disclosure was logos, plural logi. Disclosure, or logos, speaks about and declares the existence of an entity in the world, and additionally it refers to a conscious being that is aware of the event of disclosure. Hence, from the perspective of the Greeks' notion of aletheia, truth emerges from the relationship between a disclosed entity and the beholder or witness of this disclosure. Therefore, logos is the event of disclosure and the elucidation of the way in which disclosure takes place. So we can say that that which exists is disclosed through its form or species, namely through its distinctive mode of being. For instance, the form of a pot tells those who view it that the given object is a pot. However, logos is not only the individual form of beings, but also their overall formation, namely the way in which they relate to each other. And furthermore, according to ancient Greek aesthetics, the overall formation of the entities that exist in the world has kalos, which means beauty. And the Greek noun kalos is semantically related to the Greek verb kalo, meaning attract and invite. Therefore, by viewing and contemplating the overall formation of the entities in the world, Ancient Greek philosophers recognized the harmony and hence the beauty of the world from a teleological perspective. And therefore, the ancient Greeks called the universe cosmos, which in Greek is semantically related to the Greek noun kosmima, meaning jewel, ornament, and embellishment. And if I may add, the logos of the entities that exist in the world consists firstly in the way in which they participate in the corresponding species or form, and secondly, in the way in which they relate to each other in the context of the cosmic harmony and order. The logos of the cosmic entities that belong to the same species is common to all of them, and furthermore, it is unchangeable and eternal, independently of the characteristics of particular entities. For instance, every particular rose and every particular lion will perish and eventually they will be annihilated. But the form of a rose, namely its logos, or the way of its participation in existence, which makes it what it is, the given plant, and the form of a lion, namely its logos, or the way of its participation in existence, which makes it what it is, the given animal, are not susceptible to corruption, but they are unchangeable and eternal. Moreover, the set of the relations in which every particular plant and every particular animal participate, for instance, the way of a plant sowing vegetation and blossoming and the way of an animal's birth, development, and reproduction, is an integral and changeable and eternal whole. As a conclusion, that which exists actually, authentically, and hence free from corruption, change, and death is exclusively contained in the logos. Logos, therefore, means two things, as I said before. Firstly, that relationship of participation in the corresponding eternal and unchangeable form, which makes existence and existence what they are. And secondly, the relationship of participation in the formation of the entire cosmos. And especially from a Platonic perspective, true being, specifically the way of eternity and immortality, is the participation in the logos, and therefore, according to Plato, if one seeks to be immortal, then he or she must imitate the logos of the relations of participation in the formation of the cosmos. Specifically, people must understand and organize society as an event of participation in the order, harmony, and decency of the relations that constitute the eternal cosmic beauty. And in fact, this thesis underpins Plato's entire political thought and his conception of the ideal republic.
Well said, Nicolas. And yes, the term logos is, of course, Jesus, or at least Christ in the Gospel of John and the Gnostics. It's not, in the beginning was the word, in the beginning was the logos, the reason, the relationship with the divine. That's at least how I explain it to myself. And as you write in your book, logos has sort of been debased as simply meaning logic, a ratio. It's lost much of its meaning through philosophy.
Right. And far from being just syllogistic reasoning or logic or ratio, logos is the efficient and the final cause of being. It is the disclosure of the ultimate purpose of existence. In my opinion, it's a very big mistake to identify logos with a narrow perception of syllogistic reasoning.
definitely agree on that one too. And what about you, Vance? Do you have a question for Nicolas on this very fascinating conversation?
Yes, I do. I'm enjoying this a lot because the path of my life has taken me through much of this. Miguel knows, but I don't have time to explain. But Nicolas, I do have a question which I know a lot of our listeners are going to be wondering about. And in Gnosticism, you know, the classical Gnosticism, you know, the early Christian Gnosticism, there was an element that crept in that's associated with the Gnostic concept of the demiurge, which is an adversary towards humankind and manifests itself not only in the relationships between humans that you might call evil, and you'd referred to that previously, but also to the relationship between humans and the physical world. For example, predators, disease, mosquitoes, you know, all these horrible things that human beings on the surface of it don't seem to be directly responsible for. So I was interested in your comments about the Gnostic idea of the demiurge, someone that's ignorant and causes suffering, the suffering that might be built into the material world, which, you know, of course, even Gnostics didn't think existed in the Pleroma. What would you say about that?
First of all, I would say that it is ingenious and indeed consistent with the classical Gnostics attempt to spiritualize the world, to be concerned and to a certain concerned about and to a certain extent disillusioned with historical and indeed existential fact, which is the antithesis or the contradiction between the human mind and the humankind's spiritual aspirations and the brute experience of existing in the world that is alien to those aspects, to those ontological aspects of the human being and to the humankind's aspirations. So the major problem, I think, with which the Gnostics are concerned is how to explain and handle the brute experience of existing in a world that contradicts or even counters the ontology and the spiritual potential of the human being. First of all, what one can say is that Gnostics could see very well the actual state of affairs. Therefore, I think that the issue of the Gnostic demiurge as a negative force or as a source of negativity could arguably be interpreted as humanity's, specifically illuminated humanity's, awareness of a structural existential contradiction. And I would put a full stop at this point, thinking that this would be something with which, of course, both Gnostics and those who identify themselves as Orthodox with small o Christians could agree on. No one who is mentally sane, not only illuminated, not to mention illuminated, whatever that may mean, can refuse the existential fact that humanity exists and strives through and within existential contradictions, which cause, among other things, pain. However, I don't think that it is necessary or the most intellectually fecund choice to interpret demiurge as an absolutely unavoidable negativity. And I wouldn't like to surrender even this world with all its contradictions and pain. I would not like to surrender it to the demiurge. Therefore, I would like to refuse to nurture the demiurge's substance by interpreting it as an experience rather than as an ontologically deterministic fact of existence. And according to Plato's Theaetetus and Aristotle's Metaphysics, the experience of the world's contradictions and the awareness that our world is alien to humankind's aspirations can be explained and indeed handled by calling it a primal awe or wonder. Therefore, trying to overcome what emanates from the demiurge, even within his own realm, namely this world, instead of somehow subscribing or being subjugated to the demiurge's rule. And in this way, through the Greek concept of awe or wonder, which invites us and urges us to start philosophizing and thinking about how we can overcome the demiurge's overlordship, even within this world, we can give new meaning to the Gnostics' radicalism, if I may use this this term, and revolutionary spirit. So I would say that we should investigate esoteric philosophy, and this is something towards which I would like to contribute with my work, to investigate the esotericism and philosophy in general as a way of fighting the spirit of the Gnostic demiurge within the Gnostic demiurge's own realm.
That's great. That's, we talk about this all the time, and you've really given it a very clear voice. What do you think, Miguel?
Excellent. We are at the end. Vance, thanks for being here, and let me know if you have any last words.
I would like to thank you. Thank you both, and thank our listeners as well.
Oh, yeah. You know, you are very inspiring. I've heard so many things that I've pondered, and again, I can't go into detail about myself, but I think you're right on, and I think the listeners are going to enjoy this show very much. It ties a lot of things together, and I encourage everyone to tap into your material. So nice to meet you.
Keep nice to meet you. I'm grateful. Thank you.
Amen. And we only scratched the surface. There's a lot more gnosis in Nicolas's book, The Meaning of Being Illuminati. And before we say goodbye, do you have a website that people can visit, Nicolas?
It's a website about mainly my scholarly activities. It's nicolaslaos.com. The basic spelling, nicolaslaos.com.
Wonderful. I will have this in the show notes. I'll also have links to his book. Highly advise you get the book. But Nicolas, thank you very much for creating this book and coming on the show and giving us your time and your gnosis.
I want to thank you very much as well, because as I said at the beginning, you are a source of inspiration as well. Thank you very much. Thank you.
And there you have it, my beloved True Seekers. The first part of our interview with the wonderful Nicolas Laos, based on his book, The Meaning of Being Illuminati. I hope you're a little closer to breaking away from that witching screen and your micro-Plato's cave. At least start by being compassionate to others you disagree with. Divided we stand, together we rise. In our second part, Nicolas discusses Hermes, Hermeticism, and alchemy. Nicolas shares his views on free will too. He also discusses mystic Judaism, including some esoteric interpretations of the flood story that will blow you away. That includes understanding why Noah cursed Ham for seeing him naked. Nicolas then turns to the deeper meaning of what metaphysics is, including grokking what exactly is being. We get into some of the adversaries of illumination, including nominalism, the Cartesian model, and scientism. Get a bit political, including the notions of anarchism, which comes from the Greek for without archons, and much, much more. You know what's next. Please become a member or patron at Patreon for the full dope. It helps keep this Red Pill cafeteria open. Damning your soul has never been this cheap, but you get your spirit back, and you get out of your own micro-Plato's cave. We're building a Gnostic community with the Inner Sanctum of Gnosis Facebook group and the new Discord channel. Please go to the God Above God Dad Kim for means and rewards for becoming a member or patron at Patreon. Or just message me. And if you've got holes in your pockets due to the monkey shines of archons, message me too, and I'll give you any show on the burning casa. We're all in this together, and my greatest hope is to help you get out of all the Plato's caves in your existences. Find the mystery that works for you and only you. I hope I have helped. I love sending you this gnosis every week. Thanks for being here. Thanks for being yourself, your true self. Hello and goodbye as always.